You gon' see what I see in you, girl. You bad girl.
DJRSD. What's good, everybody? It's your boy Riz, aka DJRSD. You're tuning to 88.1 FM, KZSC, Santa Cruz, the Great 88. We would like to remind listeners, as a non-commercial educational radio station, KZSC supports free expression of ideas. Please be aware that the opinions expressed are those of the speakers or artists only and do not necessarily reflect the views of the UC Regents, KZSC staff, management, or underwriters. We welcome your feedback on our programming. Please direct your comments to the PRC at 831-459-4726 or by email at prc@kzsc.org. Who we got in the studio today? Drum roll, please. All right, here we go, for real. Once again, it's Riz, aka DJRSD, and today I'm currently with the Bay Area homies. The man from American Canyon, I believe. We got Jammy in the studio. We got Thomas Jordan in the studio. We got Sanny in the studio. And we got the boy Chris in the studio. How are y'all feeling today?
Great. Thanks for asking.
For sure.
Cool, bro. How about you?
We'll put the mic close to you. You good.
Yo, we in this.
Now, close to your mouth.
We aren't media trained yet.
It's all good. But how are y'all feeling today, though?
I'm feeling really great. I'm excited to be here.
For sure. What about you, Thomas Jordan?
Man, I'm feeling great, man. Thank you.
That's what's up. So... yeah, like I said, we got all the homies in the studio right now. We're doing this exclusive interview. So, Jammy,
mm-hmm.
I know your personal name is Jameer, but how did you come up with the name Jammy?
Jammy is actually a nickname that I got since I was like really, really young. My older brother gave it to me when we were like kids because I did like people used to pronounce Jeremy wrong, which my name is Jeremy, mm-hmm. and like they pronounced it wrong, and I just hated it. So they started calling me Jammy, and then I found out later that Jammy actually means lucky in slang in like British or like in England. So
okay.
And my dad's British, so it kind of all tied in, and I was like, well, let's run with it.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah,
for sure. And we got the producer Thomas Jordan in the building.
Hello.
Is Thomas Jordan your real name, or is that your producer, like, producer name?
No, actually, my real name's Tommy, and my middle name's Jordan, though, but my cousin, she gave me this nickname. She said, Thomas Jordan, you know, like, a little British accent, and I got annoyed with it, and I was like, actually, I'm gonna use that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Very interesting.
Jammy, any names before Jammy?
Man, there was Jammy D, then there was Lil J, and then I was like, let me boss up on him and hit him with the big J. But I just went with Jammy because I just felt like it just felt right at the end of the day, to be honest.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So your location, according to Pilo that you did in the remix, we'll get that into a sec, y'all. Shout out to AC. But where are you from?
I was born in San Ramon and I lived in Vallejo for about like 7 years. And then I moved to American Canyon when I was about, I can't remember how old I was. But I moved there and I've lived there ever since. So it's been like over 11 years, I think. That
okay.
I've been in AC, but I mean, I'm always back and forth between Vallejo. It's kind of like right on the borderline. You can see Vallejo from my house, and I spent most of my time there anyways.
That's what's up. Thomas Jordan, about you?
Oh, yeah. I'm from the V.
You from the V?
Shout out to V.
Your whole life?
No, I was born in Daly City, but we moved out here to Vallejo.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's see. Okay, so, Jammy, how old are you right now?
I'm 19. I turned 20 in like 2 weeks.
Okay, I'm 19 also.
Hey.
Thomas Jordan, about you?
I'm 21, sir.
21. Besides making music, what else are you doing right now?
I'm going to college full-time to study marketing and management, and then I'm also having a second AA in natural science and mathematics, but everybody who knows the AA game knows that like everybody has an AA in natural science and mathematics, but yeah.
Where'd you get your AA at?
Napa Valley College.
For sure. Where about college? Where are you heading to?
I think I should be heading to Long Beach, depending on how the music thing goes this year.
Okay.
And we'll see.
For sure. Thomas Jordan, what about you?
Oh, man, I've been doing music full time. Just making beats on the side.
Mm-hmm.
Slanging.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So when you guys listen to beats, what is the first thing y'all listen to or the thing that catches your ear? Like, is it the lyrics or is it like the synthesizer? Is it the leads? Is it et cetera? What's the first thing that catches y'all ear?
I think for me, it's a little bit different than Tommy. For me, like, I like to see how the vocals interact with like the kicks and the snares, especially.
Mm-hmm.
That's like kind of what stands out to me. So like, I try to make sure that when I pick a melody or I pick anything, it kind of plays in between the kicks or the snares, or it plays with one of those key like core things with like the music. And I think for me, like, I like to see how they interact with it, because I think that's like so creative to me, because there's so many ways you can attack a beat, like the way Pharrell attacks a beat, or way like Drake or even like Too Short would attack a beat is so different. And it's all because of, to me, or how they interact with like snares and kicks is kind of like the main thing that I pay attention to.
It's a driving force for you.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I like to use Pharrell's like rule of thumb. It's either the beat is knocking hard where you're just bobbing your head the entire time, or you're singing along to it, you know, you just got a really crisp melody, you know, something like that.
That's what I like. If y'all heard in the beginning, we opened it with some Pharrell. Thomas Jordan picked it out from the library. What's up? We got
In My Mind.
In My Mind, yep. Mm-hmm. In My Mind by Pharrell. So what is the process of making the music? Like, how long does it take? Like, what is the process? Like, what's the place you have to be in? Do you have to be, like, you guys mentioned you got a small studio.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what's the like process of making it? Like, what comes first?
Honestly, like, for Jeremy, we'll just sit down together and we're just like, hey, I'm gonna put a little autotune on you. I'll play piano while we go at it. We'll just come up with something.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's usually how it goes.
Because I like to write on a very bare instrumental. I like to write with maybe just a piano and then just a kick and then kind of build the beat around it. So me and Tommy will just like, he'll like loop some really, really, really simple beat. And then he'll just play piano for a little bit. And then we'll just like run it, and we'll just run like a freestyle that'll kind of give us like the template for the song. Mm-hmm. And then we'll just go back, and then we'll kind of build the song into what exactly we hear in our heads and kind of grow it into where it should be or where we want it to be.
Because
often it's just like, we have like all the versions and they're always just super raw and just super broken down. And then Tommy, like his ear to detail is like way crazier than mine is, and so he can like make like my little ideas into these huge ideas because his attention to detail and his knowledge of like stuff is just so crazy. So like, I like to write simple, and then he likes to kind of embellish it to where it is.
What is the type of mood are like you're feeling? It's like, is it like a smooth vibe, like, or you know, you just got done like exercising or something, then you like getting ready, or do you like wake up and then start making music? Like, what's the mood?
I think
what's the aroma?
I actually like to get into a long term relationship and then break up and then get my heart. I think that's the most effective way to write a hit.
That is true.
That's how we started. But I think for me, my mood usually is just kind of like, I like to be relaxed when I go into the studio and kind of just, I don't like a lot of stuff going on around me. I don't like a lot of people there, honestly. I don't really like, because the way I write, it's so, I just bounce ideas so like rapidly that it's like, if someone like is there too early in the process, they might disrupt from the, like the path that I'm trying to go to. Because sometimes like I like to try really, really abstract things when I write, because I want to attack a beat in as many different ways. I never want you to be like, this sounds the same. So I have to be kind of relaxed to kind of like just like see what the beat does. And I don't like a lot of people around me because I feel like their energy infuses with the energy that I'm getting from the beat usually, or the instrumentation. But yeah, I like to be relaxed. I think Tommy can kind of produce in like any setting. He just kind of goes whenever. But I don't like to write unless it's like kind of a calmer environment.
For sure.
Yeah.
Where's the weirdest place you thought of a lyric or a certain harmony or beat? Like, were you, you know, about to sleep, you know, oh shoot, I got this tumor, I'm gonna like write it down, or like, you know, play it right now? Like, where's the weirdest, like, or like you're in the car, or you're about to go eat out in the plaza or something, and you think of it, like, where's the weirdest place you thought of something?
Man, I was actually just playing around. I was I was off some like allergy pills, because I took some Benadryl and I was very sleepy. And then I started playing with piano and autotune, and then kind of came up with the chorus to Edibles. And then I was like, yo, I'm gonna shoot this to Jeremy. And then Jeremy, me and him linked, and then bam, it was like just magic.
Okay.
Yeah.
For me, like, I don't think of melodies too crazy unless like I'm like in the studio, because I like need to see the instrument or like need to hear the music for it. But as far as like rap, I think of all my like crazy one-liners and all my like punchlines while I'm at like work flipping burgers and stuff. So I'll just be like
In and Out
Napa, 126, get it. Burger flipping all day, fry guy, you feel me?
For sure.
Yeah, no, I honestly think of like all my like one-liners and punchlines while I'm like working, because it's just such like, it's the work is so easy that I'm just like focused on someone. I can like think about anything like I want to think about while still like, I don't know. It's just like, it's just, I can't think of melodies there usually, but I definitely think of like bars all the time there.
Yeah.
Because that's just my thing.
I feel it. So Thomas Jordan, you know, you mentioned, you know, do you do all the engineering and producing? Are you the ones like, you know, on the laptop, computer, et cetera? Like, do you do all that?
Yeah. Yeah, that's all me.
What do you use?
At first I was using Adobe Audition, but I do everything in FL 11. Yeah, from like making the beat to recording in it, mixing in it, you know, exporting it. That's really it. Yeah.
So who has the final word on like your production? Do you have like an executive producer, or is it just you? Like,
it's just me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just me and Jeremy. Jeremy's like, I don't like the song. I'm like, all right, I'm still gonna mix it down anyway. I don't gotta release it though, but I want it on my phone. You feel mm-hmm. me? But yeah, it's just me and him, really.
What do you think is the minimum times you have to listen to a song before you finally finish it? Like, you know, it's fully done, mm-hmm. but what's the minimum? Like, oh shoot, okay, it sounds good. But then the fourth time, you're like, oh wait, this part's Man. Off. Like, mm-hmm. how? What's the minimum?
Man, I'm gonna have to say at least 60 times, if not
60?
If not more, because mm-hmm. I listen to the stuff but after it's already come out, I don't listen to it really anymore. It's like before I spend so much time studying it and making sure that it says the exact message that like I want it to say, whether it's just like the way a word's phrased, whether it's the way the word's pronounced, or whether it's how the kick interacts with like the snare. If it like takes away from the picture that I have in my head, or the picture that I had when I originally made it, we always like try to go back in and fix that all the time.
Because mm-hmm.
cool. sometimes you'll make a song and then you'll sit on it for a couple weeks, and then you'll lose that energy when you go back in to fix it and master it and finish it, because your head's in a different space. And then it'll get frustrated because it's not sounding how you want it to sound, because it's like, it's not. And so sometimes I just have to listen to it a bunch to remember that original energy. So when we go back in and mix and master it and finish it up, it still has that original energy.
Mm-hmm.
Because that, I don't know, oftentimes when you like go back and change it, it just changes the whole feeling of the song, and it just kind of ruin a lot of songs.
Yeah.
And we've had that with a few where mm-hmm. it's just like, the main single that we're using for the project, we had written the idea for it maybe like a month before we finished it, which we just finished it the other day.
Mm-hmm.
And we went through so many different versions because it took so much time away from it. And so I probably listened to that song like hundreds mm-hmm. of times in all the different versions, just because mm-hmm. we're trying to find the best thing in it, that like the find everything that make sure that everything that's in the song actually like lends to the picture we're trying to paint.
Yeah.
And we just have to make sure sometimes, so we study sometimes, we listen to isolated vocals or just the kicks or just the snares or just everything. We listen to like, we try to listen to all the vocals without autotune, make sure they sound good without autotune, and then we put it in there, and then yeah. all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
How many times do you listen to it? I don't know.
Man, I got like 3 hours logged into that one track. just on replay.
Which one track is that?
It's called Trailblazers.
Okay.
Trailblazer, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like the main single off the new project coming up. I don't know if you wanted to say that or not.
Yeah, I mean, it's coming out soon, so mm-hmm. it's all good.
We'll get to that in a sec. But what genre do you think your music falls under?
I think it's definitely, if urban hip hop, I don't want to say urban hip hop, but it's almost suburban hip hop. Almost say that, I think it's the stories that are told are super, super just suburban. I think there's not a whole lot. I think a lot of people resonate with the stuff that we say because it's just really just suburban kid life. And I think a lot of rap is either, you know, really is speaking on a certain demographic of people that are, you know, in an economic problem, and then you have people that are there's music for people that are just really wealthy. And I think that what we speak on is kind of in that middle area, where it's kind of just, you're not necessarily super wealthy, you're not necessarily super poor, but you still have life problems and you still go through life issues. So I would say suburban, I think rap kind of fits that context the mm-hmm. best, if I was to like categorize it. How would you categorize it?
Like as our genre?
Yeah.
It's just really just whatever we chop up that day.
Okay.
Yeah, because we could go from like hip hop to like some like alternative rock stuff. Or just like, you know, like house. Not really Jeremy, but that's me. I just like
this man.
I'm a simple man, really.
Uh-huh.
He goes crazy, honestly. He can produce anything. It's crazy.
Hit up Thomas Jordan ASAP.
Mm. Definitely.
Yep. Well, if you guys are just checking in right now, once again, it's Riz, aka DJRSD, with the Bay Area homies, Jammy, Thomas Jordan, the whole crew up in here. So anyways, keep it going. What made you start making music? I think you probably explained already, but you want to go more in depth, or just
basically growing up, I think my dad's British, and then my mom is like light-skinned, and she's from like a different area than like the Oakland Hills, and she wasn't really around a lot of African-Americans growing up. So there is a certain like sever. I didn't identify with a lot of African-Americans growing up. I thought, because the values that we listened to, I didn't listen to, you know, Lauryn Hill growing up. I had to discover that later, because my dad was listening to like Bob Marley and, you know, Stevie Wonder and Soul and stuff like that, because they're a little bit older as well. And so the only way that I kind of found that I resonated with other African Americans was by like rapping. And like, so I was like, I'm gonna just rap as hard as I can every time I can freestyle, so that like I can like be respected at that point. And that's how it started. And mm-hmm. then it grew to the point where it was like, I found out that's how I could vent all my issues and how I could deal with everything that goes on in my life, is just by like writing it out. And that's how I deal with everything now. like certain emotions I don't even know how to get in touch with without writing it into a song, because it's just, I don't, it's so locked deep that I just avoid it until I get to the chance to do it. So I kind of I started rapping because I wanted to kind of resonate with other African Americans, and then I actually started making music because it was a way to, like, it was a form of therapy to deal with like all the other issues that like go on and just in life.
Oh yeah.
And it just kind of, that's how I started.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But yeah. Mm-hmm. Thomas Jordan, what about you?
Oh man, I would just be listening to a lot of Nujabes.
Yeah.
You know, Nujabes.
Hell
like
yeah.
That. Jazzy hip hop and boom bap and all that. And eventually I just discovered FL. And then, yeah, just that's how it started. You know, learned the piano a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
It played jazz band in high school and just got some basic music theory. And then, started channeling it into beat production and all that.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Did a specific artist influence your guys' work? Like, or who do you, I mean, you know, you just mentioned the artists you listen to, et cetera, but who do you look up to, or who do you feel like you can compare your sound to? I mean, I know people don't like being compared to other people, but what do you feel like you're in the midst of or around?
I think that we, as far as like in the mix of or around, I'd like to, I mean, I can't say necessarily what people would categorize me, but I'd like to say like where I think I'd like to be. And I think I'd like to be in the conversation as someone like a Childish Gambino, a Kyle, a Yachty, just where a place where it's a positive energy that's not necessarily tainted by like the success of fame. I know Childish Gambino is a little bit on the other side of that, but I kind of want to play on like a happier side of that, where it's like taking whatever is in life and kind of making the best out of it, and making sure like everyone knows that everyone goes through the same things.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I'd want to be in that like that kind of happier, like Kyle, Childish Gambino, and like the younger Childish Gambino at least, and then you know, Chance, of course, because I mean that's dude.
Yeah,
Acid Rap is my favorite album of all time.
For
even
sure.
Though it's just a mixtape, that's still my mm-hmm. favorite for sure.
Yeah, definitely. I think Kanye West is definitely one of my major inspirations. At least his like college dropout days,
mm-hmm.
and just like the beats and like the emotions that you feel from that, and also Kid Cudi and his
playing
his,
that right now. If y'all hear in the background,
mm-hmm, shout out. Nah, his yeah, just the way his music heals people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because people they turn to music to escape like life and stuff like that, and I feel like Kid Cudi's like his energy and his music is just it's really just it's a healing energy, you know.
Yeah,
and that's what I love about it. That's what I'd like to be, honestly.
Mm-hmm. So Jammy, I think the first time I heard you was song Margarita, and that got 4,700 plays and edibles, which is just blown up now, has over 25,000 plays. Was it a relief to see how many plays you got? Or was that even, like, the goal to, like, get thousands of plays now? Was that, like, what were you thinking of making the song?
I was hoping that we would get 1,000 plays.
Okay.
Like, that was really, really exciting. I remember calling everyone and, like, we finally got 1,000 plays, and this is so dope. And it's like, I don't know. It's really crazy that that's happened, and I didn't think that was going to happen. I think we put that song out because we wanted to do a whole video with it, and we wanted to do this crazy rollout.
Check out that video. Video dope.
And thank you. Shout out to Kane. He's a dope.
Shout out
video.
Kane.
Yeah, Kane. Hey, mm-hmm. Kane. That's his ad on Twitter. But we just kind of put it out. I think Tommy was like, bro, we need to put some music out, because we've been working for music for like 4 or 5 months. We'd had maybe 10 songs that are stacked up, and he's like, dude, you got to put some stuff out. And so we had put out Margarita, and he's like, we need to put something else out. I don't know what else we're going to put. And we had that edible song. We're like, let's put it out. And we just were excited that. And then it just kind of, it took a long time to kind of get to where it's at.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't like, I don't know. It snowballed in like a slower way. It like didn't get enough track. It didn't start getting traction until like at least like 2 months after it came out, which is pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
And we just kind of, and then it just kind of like went to where it is now, which is really, really cool.
Mm-hmm.
Which is cool on like a local level, having people know your music, and it's not just your friends that listen to it. That's really, really, really crazy to me.
Mm-hmm.
I still don't like understand it sometimes, that like people that don't know me sometimes listen to it.
Yeah.
Which is really, really cool. That's
mm-hmm.
I don't know. That's something I didn't think that would happen.
Yeah.
Honestly, so that's really cool that other people that aren't my friends listen to it.
Mm-hmm.
Cause I kind of made it originally just for like my friends to listen to and slap around, and Chris does all the time. And then that's kind of the main person I make it
Shout
for.
Out Chris and the Stu. We'll get into him in a sec.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what I thought was just my friends to listen to. And it was just a song that like our friends could live their lives to. And
mm-hmm.
it's crazy that other people are kind of starting to do that same thing.
Yeah. What about you, Thomas Jordan? What were you thinking of like at the time?
At the time, I was just trying to release something, you know, show people our art and share something with somebody else. And then I ended up getting some plays. And then, you know, people started coming into the circle, you know, and like, you know, because we released, you know, art, it just, it's something. It blows my mind, honestly. Like,
yeah.
Just to see like the amount of like life that like, you know, filtered in after like we started making music. And mm-hmm. It's crazy. I wouldn't have met Sanny without that. Wouldn't have met Chris. Wouldn't have met Jeremy, you know. Mm-hmm. But I mean, I probably knew you.
I think we met.
Yeah, it's just like the connections that just come off of just, you know, just you wanting just to show someone like a song that you made, you know.
Hell yeah.
Like it's crazy. It's really crazy. So
little homie in the room in the room. Once again, we are back. It's Riz, aka DJRSD, with special guests in the studio, Jammy and Thomas Jordan. We're back. During the break, we were talking about you know, Kid Cudi and all the Lil B 808s and just, or Kanye 808s and just all the old stuff. And like, you know, they're, what's that? Inspiring like the new wave of music today. If you guys were to have an ultimate playlist to make of your favorite artists and like different genres, who would be on that personal playlist?
Oh, man. Man, I'm gonna have to bring out the Cuddies.
No, it's all good. This question gets everybody.
I think I'm gonna have to put the Avett Brothers, and probably nobody knows who they are, but they're like a folk group that goes crazy. Their album or their song Paranoia in B minor is honestly my favorite song of all time. And they're like a folk band, they go crazy. I probably have to put some Kings of Leon on there. Come Around Sundown, because that's like my album. Definitely got to put some Kanye on there. My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy, and then the intro to Graduation, for sure. Mm-hmm. Who else would I put on there? Definitely the entire Acid Rap album. And any feature that Chance had during the Acid Rap days has to be on there, because that man was literally going stupid.
Hell yeah.
Man, who else? Donald Glover, definitely. Childish Gambino, that's for sure. Who else would I be listening to? Daniel Caesar's crazy.
Daniel Caesar.
Hey, shout out Daniel Caesar. He's actually coming to UC Santa Cruz as a pop-up concert with 108K. They'll be on Saturday. They'll be on May 6th.
So, dang, yeah. That's dope. I'm jealous.
Get some tickets, bro.
It's free.
Maybe we might have to mob.
Might have to take notes.
Saturday, if y'all ain't doing anything. I know it's big stuff going on.
It's very big.
Yeah, for sure. What would be on your playlist, bro?
Man on the Moon. Mm-hmm. Man on the Moon. If I have a female over, you feel me? I might switch over to some Daniel Kaiser.
This man, it's Caesar, yeah. Like the salad, brother.
Yeah, he definitely got the funk.
Yeah, he goes crazy, yeah.
Yeah, I actually can't even think of anything right now, because that's a hard question.
I feel it.
Oh, yeah. Definitely got to put some Rexx like Rod.
We're about to talk with Sammy in a sec about that. Or Sanny, my fault. It's my fault.
I definitely forgot to put Rod in there. Like, that is not like someone I play every day.
What about Bay Area artists? Let's limit it down to Bay Area artists.
All right, Bay Area artists, I got you. We gotta have Sugar Free on there, because that man is crazy and nobody knows about Sugar Free. Mm-hmm. We gotta throw on there definitely Rexx Live Raj, because I mean, it's Rexx Live Raj, honestly. Siri, she's from Oakland, she's crazy. Mm-hmm. I just met her the other day, tapped in with her, she's super cool. Definitely gotta be P-Lo, of course. And mostly HBK Gang, because they go crazy. My little sister Kazia, because she's wild.
Shout out Kazia.
Who else from the Bay do we? Dave Steezy's cool. Larry June's pretty dope.
Larry June's very dope, yeah. Man, his ad-libs are very hard.
Tell me.
This man really be saying anything on his ad-libs and he goes crazy.
Yeah.
Who else? I'm trying to think of female artists from the Bay.
That's not Kehlani.
Yeah, that's... I mean, like, of course, you know... That's Kehlani, you gotta love Kehlani. Yeah, mm-hmm. But I'm trying to think of like some other artists. I mean, Kamaya's dope.
Yeah, Kamaya.
It's Kamaya.
I mean, she goes crazy.
Ooh, One Oak.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Shout out to him.
Yeah.
Producing stuff left and right.
Who do we meet the other day? What's her?
Alujay,
yes.
What? She's,
and Eileen Shoji?
Yes.
No
I saw her. I saw her perform the other day, and she's crazy. She's mm-hmm. dope. Mm-hmm. Like her stage presence is like.
Yeah, she had the entire crowd rocking with her.
Yeah.
On some smooth stuff.
That's what's up.
It was crazy.
Yeah, but she's dope.
Yeah.
Anyone else that you're thinking of?
Are you on FaceTime?
Yeah, I gotta call a little sister.
Hey, it's all good.
Little sister had to pop up. Say hi, Kazia.
Say what?
Hello.
Hey, we got Kazia. Shout out to her.
Kazia's here in the stew.
Kazia's
for sure.
Here in the stew.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ask.
Oh dang, we forgot SOB.
I might just have to quit.
They're gonna come for me, bro.
Yeah.
No, SOB goes stupid. Slimmy, T.O. Bro, they're geniuses with how they've marketed themselves and branded themselves.
Oh,
and
put def.
wild.
My man's shout out to B-Giggs with the
B-Giggs
with the snaps. You feel
shout out B-Giggs with the camera work.
B.J. Cooper.
If you don't know about B-Giggs, you are sleeping. That's the truth. This man is crazy.
But yeah, I don't know how we didn't remember them, man. I'm messing up.
No, that's all
I
good.
Think we were thinking too hard. We didn't want to look on the shallow level. You feel me? Because I mean, like, you can't. I don't know. You can't be from Vallejo and not have SOB on your playlist. Yeah, that's not a thing.
It's mandatory
for sure
at this point.
Oh yeah, YMTK goes crazy too.
Oh yeah, YMTK.
Yeah, YMTK. Yeah, I have YMTK. A song with them that's coming out pretty soon. That's gonna be dope.
That's Pat Man.
So
that's about to go wild.
All right, so back to the thing. So you made a remix with P-Lo on Edibles. Explain to the listeners how you got to make that connection. That caught me by surprise. I was like, what is going on?
I'm gonna have to look over here at Sanny real quick. And just
all right, we got Sanny. Sanny, what's up with you?
Man, what up?
dad in this thing. We got Sanny. We got DJ San on the mic. Get it, please.
Man, how did that happen?
So how'd that happen, Sanny? I know you're affiliated with Rexx Live. We'll get to that in a sec, but how did that remix work with P-Lo?
So I heard the song Edibles.
Kane.
Where did that start? Yeah, from Kane. I'm trying to think.
Was it I think Kane was supposed to do behind the scenes. My videographer was supposed to do behind the scenes for P-Lo for one of his videos. I think it was the one that just came out.
Oh, no, I remember now. Okay, so look, I sent, who was it? I was talking to Kelly. Shout out Kelly.
Shout out Kelly. Keep it lit.
I had sent him some of Jammy and Kazia's music, actually.
Hell yeah.
And he was just like, man, like, I really mess with these young dudes. Like, I'm trying to work with them. And I'm like, okay, cool. And I sent him Edibles. That was one of the songs. And I guess he was in L.A. with P-Lo at the time.
That's right. So, you know, the snap.
Mm-hmm. And he was listening to it. He was just blapping it out loud, you know, in the Airbnb or whatever. And I guess P-Lo heard it. And he's like, man, who is this? Like, what's up? I'm trying to get on this. And then that's how it happened, I guess. He just got in the studio. And that's how that happened.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Crazy.
Yeah, that was wild.
Shout out P-Lo.
Shout out Kelly, big tunes.
Time to bring the bass back.
Yes, those two go stupid. I need production from both of them off
hell
tops.
Yeah.
Yeah, those are for real. Like some legends. And we're, man, that opportunity was very crazy.
Yeah, it was surreal. I remember we were still working. We were working on the tape, I think, when we got the text message that P-Lo said he wanted to do it. Kelly was like, hey, can you send me your edibles with an open 16? And I was like, what?
What?
And we were like, man, we got to do this now. We're really like doing it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like,
and we sent it over, and then we met him once, and he was really cool, and we chopped it up with him, really dope dude. And then he like sent it back, and it was really fire, and I was like, it was crazy because it brought my sound to a Bay Area sound, because I know like with my ear or the sound that the music that we make is kind of a little bit off-putting from the stuff that's coming out from the Bay, and it's just cool that we had a Bay Area legend kind of say like, hey, it's still cool, it's still Bay Area. Yeah,
well, for sure.
It's just attacked it differently.
Definitely like nodded his head at us, you know.
And, yeah, yeah.
Man, like it's crazy, man. Yeah. Sanny, bro. Sanny, bro, I never got a chance to really thank you for that, but
thank you, Sanny.
Shout out, we're really grateful for Sanny. This man's a legend, bro.
That's the manager right there. Yeah.
So,
this dude.
Yeah, so like, you know, you have a bunch of people, you know, getting your songs out there, advertising, etc. Do you have an outreach team? Like, I noticed, you know, you rock with three other people in this room. You know, you got your producer, you got Sanny doing this no platform thing, which we'll talk about in a second. You got your boy Chris. Do you have an exact outreach team? Like, okay, you're doing this, you post this there, you take a picture here, etc. Y'all bought all your gear here too. I'm that's what's up. Like, you know, kept it in a moment. But like, yeah, like I said, do you have an outreach team?
I think that we all kind of take up our own individual roles in like the group, as like sometimes it's about like, for me, I'm in charge. If it's on my page, I'm in charge of it. If it's like coming out on my page, I've decided I want to put it out. I put it out the way I want to put it out. I think if it's on Thomas Jordan's, it's the same way. But as far as documenting and making sure it all gets pushed, I think we have the Love Team, which is a clothing brand that's really crazy. And they just kind of take pictures of everything just because, you know, Love Team, and they take pictures and we post them. And like, that's kind of like how we just have everyone taking pictures. If you see like all of us have cameras, and we just kind of use that to post those pictures periodically to kind of keep the interest in us going. But we don't really have a specific team for it. It's kind of just all of us kind of doing it together, but like with, you know, one like if it's your page or it's your art, you're kind of in charge of how that comes out, but we all support it regardless, and we all retweet it And we have the no platform background, which is new. We just started building that, and that has helped us out a lot. It helped a lot of artists out a lot, actually, and given us the platform to perform and given us a couple of events to kind of perform and giving us a lot of events just in general. And I think the no platform is kind of where we're going to lean eventually to kind of putting all of our premieres out on there and using that as kind of a huge medium, because I think that just the vision of it, you know, having Sanny at the head of it, is just, I think that allowing a place for artists that are different, allowing a place where people that kind of want to do music that aren't necessarily staying in the same lane as everyone else, no platform kind of offers us the platform, which is kind of the dopest part about it, is it kind of gives us like a place for us to, like, because we make music that's different, and it's kind of hard to get places that want to market that sometimes, because it's different. It's not the SOB sound, it's not a Larry June sound, it's just not a sound that's really easy to kind of find.
Yeah.
And so sometimes people are scared because they're not sure how that's going to be marketed. And so that's why I think that no platform is such a powerful medium, is because it's allowing artists that aren't necessarily, they cover everything, but they cover everything. You know, they cover all different genres. We had an artist, Ray, that dropped a song on called Mangoes that was pretty crazy. Mm-hmm. And no platform debuted it, and it was his biggest debut yet, because it's like we're allowing people to come in and look at the art, you know what I mean? And it's like art from all different places. And I think that type of energy is branching out to like everything. I think people that are supporting no platform are all about the different types of energy.
Hell yeah.
And it's because there's nothing behind us, you know. It's a new company, so it's a new everything. So mm-hmm. You know, I think that's kind of a long-winded way of answering that, but yeah. I think we don't have a team yet, but no platform is the team.
Hell yeah.
We're building right now.
We ain't got no PR right now.
We're building it right now, I guess, is the short answer to that question.
All right, y'all. PSA, they need a...
We're not
outreach team. You feel me?
We're not tripping.
Not tripping.
For surely not.
Hell yeah. But sidetrack to Sanny, we got Sanny up in here. How did you come up with that no platform idea? I know, well, me personally, first time I heard of Sanny was West Coast Kicks, and all that shoe stuff, you know, getting good deals. I'm going to thank Sanny personally right now, because he got me paying off my college debt right now with just selling shoes off West Coast Kicks. I really appreciate that. Like, I really appreciate that. Like, you have no idea, like, what that means to me. But can you describe that no platform life? Like, what is it? I know Jammy just explained a bit, but want to hear from you, the main man.
Yeah, so, I mean, I've been a part of, like, a couple of different, like, media outlets. Like, I've been a part of Thizzler. I've helped out with, like, Free Bread a little bit. And then I've just always been interested in that type of stuff. And no platform is kind of like a media outlet, but it's also going to be, like, an umbrella for a bunch of other stuff. Like, I wanted to encompass, like, events and, like, art shows and, like, pretty much just culture. Mm-hmm. And a media outlet is just going to be a part of it. And that's pretty much like what it is, I guess. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How did you link up with Rexx Live? You know, you got the Rexx Live hat right now.
Oh yeah, Raj, man, shout out Rexx Live, Raj. I had linked up with him actually, because I used to, or I still do, but I do photo videos, and graphic design stuff. I met him actually. I was helping out one of my homies with a video shoot, and Raj was I think he was one of the ghostwriters for the song, because that's what he used to do. And he had no music out at the time, and I was just helping out with the video. It was like a party video or something, and they just needed background music. So I was playing some Travis Scott, actually, like some early Travis Scott, before people really knew about him. And Raj was, he's like a real music head, so he picked that up, and he just came up to me and just started chopping it up with me, like, super cool dude. We connected through that, and then a couple months later, he had hit me and was like, I'm about to start dropping music, and he knew that I was doing like photos and stuff, and he's like, I wanted you to do like photos for me. And then he found out I did artwork, and I just started doing his artwork, and we just been homies since.
That's what's up.
Yeah, shout out Raj,
shout out the whole Rexx Live. I remember seeing stuff on Twitter. It was like, okay, like directed by Sanny, or just like filmed by Sanny, just all that stuff. That's what's up, man. Like, that's what the whole like Bay Area is about. Like I mentioned earlier, I was talking to these guys, like, we're just all about putting people on, helping, how can we make everyone around us, you know, successful and all that. Yep. Just going to no platform, and I also did an interview with More Art James. Shout out James Gilbo.
Yeah, shout out James.
More Art this weekend, let's get it.
why do you think people should go to those events where people showcase art, let's see, clothing,
in music. Why do y'all think people should go to events like that? Just from your guys' perspective.
I think for me, growing up as kind of like an outcast and someone who didn't really fit in, it's kind of crazy how all of the people that didn't really fit in found a place that we all fit in. And I think that everyone at More Art is just a bunch of young creatives. And I think that if you're kind of find yourself in that box where maybe, you know, you're in school and you kind of feel like you're not necessarily getting the enrichment that you need, which I know it sounds kind of weird, but just as an artist, you kind of crave certain things, certain like energies that you're not getting that energy. I think if you ever have time or you'd like to check that out, it's just a place where you can kind of go and have fun. I don't think there's a lot of judgment there. I don't think there's a lot of, it's just kind of a supportive group of like people that just want to dance and have a good time and listen to music and kind of submerge themselves in the culture. So if you're trying to like, I don't know, have fun with people that are like you, people that want to have a good time, it's definitely a place to do that. And
definitely
shout out to James for that and creating just a place for that, and also helping out with us too. I mean, that dude's doing what he's got to do and he's doing a great job at it. Shout out to Guava Gang, shout out to Nosotros, there's a bunch of different people that are doing that, and they're all doing it really great. And I just will encourage everyone, if you like have a time to check out one of those parties, definitely go check them out, because it's a dope place to go and just like hear new artists and dance and have a good time. I don't know how
what
else
more,
to
what more else do you need, you
know? Yeah, definitely not.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think that's what I would encourage you to go to that for
definitely,
sure.
Definitely.
Yeah, now another thing I think too is especially out in Vallejo, there's not much to do for like the youth. Like there's nothing to do out there. So I think it's just like a good place for people to go to like have fun. Networking is also an important thing. You meet a lot of people at those type of events.
All right, we're back. Shout out to everyone who is still tuned in. We got the technical difficulties fixed.
Hey.
Monitor was tripping, but it's all good. You know, KZSC, we learned the station. Well, like, from ground up, you feel me? Anyways, so we were just talking about No Platform and More, I believe. I know I did an interview, like I said, with James, and I used a couple pictures by like a couple photographers for the More Art interview I did, and that's why I saw your picture too. So I know you performed at a couple of More Art events. Which was the most cracking event that you experienced?
I feel like they're all cracking in different ways, but I think as far as me, for like the one that was the best for me was definitely More Art 2, which was the first time I ever got to perform. It was just crazy. We just kind of went into like crazy mode and just went stupid on stage and just turned up like ridiculously. I think like lately, I think the format for how the live shows have just been in a lot of these art parties, it's just been kind of a little weird, and it's been kind of harder for the artist to kind of get a good reaction out of the crowd. But I think just how that Force More Art was set up was just so easy for the crowd to kind of just get ready to just dance for it. And it was really fun. Honestly, I had a really, really great time. And I think the first one was my favorite one. What about you?
Yeah, same. I was about to tell you. I was like, the second one. It was amazing because we had a little talk before we all went up. We had about like three of us, Devon, me, you, Kazia, and they were feeling shaky. And I was like, huddled them up, you know, did my job as a producer. I was like, hey, y'all got this, you know? And then I looked them in the eyes. I was like, let's get it, you know, let's get it. And then they did. So it was cool.
Hell yeah. I feel it. So if you guys like to, can you specifically describe a moment in your life that helped you make you become who you are today? Like a specific, any specific moment. Like if it could be the smallest thing to the biggest thing. But you guys can answer if you want to, but like I said, this is the time for listeners to get to know you more as a person, because you never know
the next person what
they're gonna ask you.
Man, one specific thing. Man, I don't know. Do you have anything like ideas?
I don't know, No, I probably shouldn't say it, but
there was
a moment where I did a specific drug, and it actually it melted my depression off me, and like it allowed me to like create like art and like release it, and it was just crazy. It was kind of like a moment. I'm not gonna say what it is, but like it definitely was a shift in like my life.
Definitely huge for him. I think for me, I think it was the transition from high school to college and realizing that the values that like and the things that are important to people around me, the people that were also in like the academic environment or, you know,
weren't the same things that I thought were important. They weren't the same things that I wanted to strive for. I didn't think that, like, I didn't want to have a desk job and sit there for the rest of my life. That didn't, I never once was something I wanted to do ever. And I think that that transition to seeing that, like, how close I was to becoming, you know, your average person and just working at a desk job, which is awesome if that's what you want to do, but I couldn't do it. And I realized that, like, I had to find some other way to express myself, or some other, I had to find something, an outlet to do that, to express myself and also, you know, make a career out of. And I think music just kind of was that. So I think for me, the biggest change for me was that transition from high school to college,
yeah,
and feeling like I didn't belong again. And I hadn't felt that feeling until, and since I was, you know, really, really young, and I had turned to musical theater at that point. And the older I got, it was like musical theater wasn't something that really gave me that same enjoyment anymore. But I wanted to still perform, and I wanted to still create music and put stuff out. So I think, yeah, definitely that transition from high school to college was kind of the biggest thing for me.
Hell yeah. I mean, that's what, I mean, that's what a lot of, like, us college students, you know, just struggle with. I mean, that's what I personally struggle with too. Just the, like, for personally me, just a culture shock, you know, from Bay Area, you feel me, Vallejo, now we're out here, I'm out here at UC Santa Cruz, like, oh shoot, we're focused on different genres, you know, listening to different things, etc. So yeah, I totally agree with you that, with that culture shock, but, or I mean, just the transition. But anyways, if you were to make a super song, either of you, like a super song, who would you have on that song? Anybody? Like, you, like, oh shoot, it's this famous artist right here, this person's gonna make a song with you, who would you have?
Frank Ocean, SZA, and Pharrell.
Why?
You're just so, my favorite artists.
You're so right with that, though. Why did you hit that right on the nose? Like, I'm so mad you got me. I was literally gonna say, I think I'm the only person I might have exchanged, I might have exchanged SZA for Chance, but other than that, but at the same time, SZA's so raw. No, you definitely hit it on the nose with that.
Yeah, it's a balance. It's a good balance.
That would be crazy.
Masculine and feminine energy.
I'd cry. I'd cry. Damn,
I would. Here. I would. I would actually melt.
I definitely would.
Yeah.
Not be okay after that. For sure.
Pants would have to be changed after that. At that point.
Definitely. Yeah. Definitely. New pants. New everything at that point.
What would the song be about, Thomas Jordan?
Man,
I don't even know. I would just, like, yo, they could literally babble about nothing, and I'd love it. Yeah.
That would be crazy.
Yeah.
Definitely.
That's the same with you, Jammy. That's who you would have for
definitely,
a super song?
Yeah, I think definitely Frank, and SZA's crazy, and Pharrell is insane. On a more, like, realistic plane, I definitely want a Rexx Live Raj feature. Like, but
Rexx Live, hope you listen to this right now. Listen,
Raj is not listening to this. But my dude,
send,
like,
that archive, SoundCloud,
he better find that for me. No, he's like one of my favorite artists, just growing up in the Bay, just seeing him kind of do his thing, and getting a chance to have met him once or twice. He's just really, really cool, and someone that I aspire to be, because it's just his work ethic is crazy. And it makes me inspired to, like, work. And I know that, like, a bunch of other artists have that same work ethic where it's like they wake up every day and they go to the studio and that's all they do. But it's the first, he was the first person I think that I got to meet who was a rapper who did that and was making quality music. And so, like, he influenced me a lot just because he was someone that was really close to me.
Yeah.
Or not close, but, like, just, like, I was able to actually, you know, reach out and get to know him on, like, the little level that I do know him. I've only met him a couple times, but, like, just the way he, just how his work ethic is, and just seeing how many hundreds of songs that he has that are done, that are incredible, that are dope and individual. That's why I, like, really would like to collab with him, just because just seeing his work ethic is so inspiring.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, I think that would definitely be.
He definitely is like an idol too.
Definitely.
Someone to look up towards.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
But he's dope. He's I don't know, his stuff is crazy. But yeah, definitely. I think either, you know, Frank Ocean or SZA or Pharrell or Rexx Live Raj feature, which is funny to put that in the, but I think he'll be up there in like a year or two for sure.
You never know.
Yeah.
He's dope. Gotta earn that one though.
Yeah. Let's see. Do you think with all the plays you guys have right now, or just the things you're doing, do you feel like you feel successful? Like, this is where you want to be?
No.
Or do you want to reach higher?
Way higher. No,
how much higher are we talking about?
I definitely am not gonna stop until I'm the biggest artist from the Bay, and that's real talk. Like, I don't, like, I'm not even messing around, like, on, like, any other level. Like, that's what I want.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's not competition, it's not anything. That's what I will be. And, like, I'm nowhere near that. I'm nowhere near where I need to be as an artist, as a rapper, as a singer, as I'd like to be able to at least produce some of my own stuff. I'd like to be able to, you know, run my own sessions, and I'm nowhere near, as far as success, I don't think we could do a show and headline it and sell it out. We're not there yet.
Yeah.
And
I don't think we could do an arena tour. We don't even think it's, there's so many, if we leave the Bay Area, are we even Vallejo, our specific hometown, are we even really recognized? And we're not. So that, I want to be to the point where we're able to do shows all over the world and all over the place. And, you know, I think the money and all that stuff will come later. That's not, I'd rather be respected as like a lyricist, as a performer, mm-hmm. as just as a person in the industry. And that's what I'd like. I think we have a long way to do go to get respected, and then we'll get those plays and those views and those opportunities. Because I think right now we're at a really, really cool place to be. You know, we've only been putting music out for 6 months, we only have 3 songs out, and we're getting a lot of really cool opportunities. But that's nowhere near where I think I see us going, or where I'd like us to go. And until we get there, I'm not gonna stop like resting or working, and because it's like a hunger. It's like I wake up, if I don't, you know, write a verse or write a song, I have anxiety. I can't sleep, or I can't even rest, because it's like, and I get grouchy because of it. Like if I had like take a week off, I'm like grouchy. I'm like upset because I have so many ideas in my head all the time. And it's like all like, because I want to be one of those artists that can literally make any different type of genre of music. And when we show you some music later, we're going to show you that we have like, we literally run down the list of different stuff that we like try.
Hell yeah.
Because I think I don't want to ever be trapped in a box. And I think every artist that I respect creates a new sound every time they drop a project.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to be on that wave. And until I'm able to like master sounds, like drop an album that's a totally new sound and it's great and it's and, like it's really a solid piece of work, I'm nowhere near where I need to be as an artist. And that's going to take a long time. And that's exciting too in and of itself. Knowing that, like, just as you and I are both sophomores in like college, knowing that you have more college to go, is it same? It's like a sad thing, but it's also an awesome thing because you have so much. You know, you have so much more to grow in the specific environment,
yeah,
and
yeah.
That's kind of how I would like think about music. Is it's like I know that like I have more to grow as an artist, and so I keep working every day. It's like, you know, you have another year after this, so you're not gonna drop all your ball of your homework. You're not gonna just stop going to class. You're not gonna just stop because you know that you're putting that work in so you can do something else. And for me, that music is that something else, and that those shows and those plaques and the respect that comes with that is what I think is more important to me than getting. That's why like I don't care too much about my degree, is because I care more about that. Mm-hmm. Because that's something that I'm like, I worked for that, and I did that. Mm-hmm. And me and Tommy did that together, and we built that, and we're starting at such a good place, and we're having such a good pace, and now it's just about maintaining that pace and maintaining quality and maintaining. That's why we're not just dropping music out of the blue. That's why we're spending extra time on stuff and making sure our packaging is right, making sure that, like, because I don't want to just be a SoundCloud artist. I want to be an artist. I want to be, and not that there's incredible SoundCloud artists, but I don't want to ever be in a box like that.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be able to, you know, eventually have my own cartoon show and eventually be able to do all this other stuff, because I think that you're selling yourself short when you say you can only do one thing.
Yeah.
Whether that one thing is music, whether that one thing is college, whether that one thing is that, you're selling yourself short because you are so capable of doing something that someone else can't do.
Oh yeah.
And I, until I can like, and that's kind of, I mean, of course I always give long-winded answers, but
that's good. No, the listeners need to hear that. Yeah. It's important.
That's until I reach that point where I feel like I'm able to do that, and I'm able to hold my own and as just as a person, as an artist, as everything, mm-hmm. then I don't think I've achieved where I want to achieve. And I don't know if I'll ever achieve that. And that's awesome. And I don't really care, because I want to keep pushing myself to achieve that.
Mm-hmm.
Because once I achieve that, then I got to achieve something else that's even bigger. And I don't know what that is yet. So
mm-hmm.
I'm okay with not being there yet, but I'm working every day to be there.
Yeah.
Because that's where I want to be. And that's where I think I will be. Not I think I will be there. So the mindset I think Tommy and I both have is that we will do this.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's, and that's why we work every night, because it's like, we will do this. There's no other options. Tommy doesn't have a fallback. I barely have a fallback. I'm not flipping burgers for the rest of my life.
Mm-hmm.
Never. I'm not doing that. And I'm not going to sit at a desk job and not create, because I can't do it. I don't know. I can't do it. And I just will not do that ever. And I've told myself that, and I want to make sure that like, even just listeners know that like, you really are capable to do anything you want to do,
mm-hmm.
if you just work. And my dad said something that like always resonated with me. He's like, you can have anything you want in life if you're willing to pay the price for it. And that always resonated with me. And the price of being successful is definitely steep. It's like, and we're not even there yet, and we have already like experienced things that are, we've lost friendships, I'm distant from family because I don't hang out with people, like,
yeah,
my relationship with my like girlfriend is like definitely struggles because of how busy I am and how focused I am on something else. And it's like, I'm willing to give all that up because this is bigger than me. This is something that like our city could be proud of, our town could be proud of, our state could be proud of, my parents could be proud of, my grandkids could be proud of. And until like I'm able to show them something that they can always be proud of, then I haven't achieved anywhere near what I need to achieve, because mm-hmm. that's, I don't know, it's just too much for me. Like, I don't know, there's too much to accomplish to be proud of.
Yeah.
To be proud of our little success.
What about you, Thomas Jordan? Like,
let's just take everything he said. I second that. I second that. He really just spoke for both of us. And like, I can't emphasize enough like how important, you know, like what everything he just said was.
Yeah.
So I have to say nothing else. I'll say less.
All right, what about production wise? Like, what improvements can you make going forward producing? Like, I know it takes a long time to like produce things, et cetera, but what improvements can you make? Like, what can you cut short or like find shortcuts to? Or do you feel like, you know, you just need to do everything step by step by step, no shortcuts?
Like, I'd like to know like every step of the way, but I feel like I could improve on a lot of stuff, like as far, not creatively, but like, I don't know how to master as good as like maybe like, you know, someone more seasoned than I am, you know. That's something I'll learn, like, you know, through the course of time though. But like, until then, like, it's just, you know, I'll make some mistakes and I'll learn from them, and like, that's really all you can do. Yeah.
What about you, Jammy? What improvements can you make?
I think I can improve in the way of branching out as far as subject matter. I think I stay in a very comfortable, or I have in this project, because the whole entire project's a giant love story, as I've been very comfortable in a box of just, you know, reflecting on past loves and like using love as fill relationships as a muse for music. And I think I'd like to branch out from that and eventually, you know, look at other elements of life, you know, because life is so much more than that. And that's just gonna be, I'm young, you know, I'm 19 and I haven't lived, I mean, I've been like this last 5 months of this year, I've lived more, I feel like, than I've lived in the past like 2 years of college, because it's, I'm meeting people that I've never, types of people I've never met before, and I want to be able to write music for them too, you know, and write music that they can kind of feel too, like people that I didn't grow up with and people that I didn't grow around. And so that's just coming with, like, I want to be able to branch out and write more like that, more stuff that like it'll hit more people. Definitely is kind of where I'd like to go.
So, you know, you mentioned you got like a whole love story tape or album, whatever, project dropping. What can you give the fans an idea of when this new heat will be dropping, or what should we be expecting, or who's going to be on it? Any people you're collaborating with that, or that you can leak out? You never know.
This project is actually just going to be me and Tommy the whole entire way through.
No way.
Yeah, just me and T. And we wanted to do that because me and Tommy have started this entire thing together.
Yeah.
You know, before No Platform, before we met Sandy, before we met Kazia, before we did More Art, before we did any of that stuff, me and Tommy had just a piano, an FL Studio 11, and we just kind of started making music together. And I feel like I wouldn't feel right to do this project without Tommy, because I owe Tommy half of my sound. I think our sounds are together, and I wanted this project to kind of show. There are certain songs on the project that more are on Tommy's side of it, like for instance Margarita, a song we have called I-5, and even Edibles is more on his side. You have songs like Trailblazer, which I'll show you later, and that's the debut single. It's also the name of the project. That's more on my side, and songs like Moon are more on my side. And then we just kind of find ways to kind of like find both our styles and collaborate with them to the point where it's like these songs sound very different and very distinct,
yeah,
and very different styles that we didn't necessarily feel like we needed to get any features on it to say what we wanted to say. And we're almost done with our project. We're about one song away, so it's possible we could still get a feature, but at this point right now there's no features on it.
How many tracks are we talking?
It's seven.
Seven. Why seven?
Basically, it's the year of the seven. Raj actually said that one time, and I was like, you know what? I'm gonna have to run with that one. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I had to pick up game from Dad. You feel me? The father figure. But yeah, he said something about seven, and then it kind of, to me,
a project, your first project should be very short, because you haven't earned the respect of the listener to listen to, you know, 40 minutes of you, or no, an hour of you. You just haven't earned that, and you can't be mad at the listener for not wanting that necessarily.
Yeah.
So we wanted to make sure that the project is short enough that you either want to run it back, or, you know, you can at least have heard it all. Mm-hmm. You know, whether you didn't want to play it again, you can hear it all in one take. You can hear it all in one drive to Sonoma, or one drive to SAC, or whatever. You can hear that entire project multiple times on those shorter drives.
Yep.
So like, that's what we wanted you to be able to do, is because it's definitely a driving music summer playlist album. It's or like mixtape. It's definitely more of a summer driving like thing. So we wanted to make it so it's like enough that you would have to play the songs over and over again.
Yeah.
And yeah, so we did 7 songs.
Tell about the comic book too.
Oh yeah, we're also doing a comic book to accompany the project. And that's
comic book. That's yes. Wow. Okay.
Yes, this is the first time we've ever discussed it out like publicly. But we're actually working on a comic book right now that actually illustrates the same storyline of the project, but it illustrates it in a slightly different way. It's focused around a character that's me, but it's definitely a fictionalized character of myself. And we're about a couple pages into the comic book. We're still working on getting it all illustrated, but we have some really cool people lined up to do the illustration. I don't want to speak on it just yet because I want to make sure we have it all locked in.
Yeah.
But it's going to be really cool because it's just an interesting way, because I think that music is so visual to me, at least. I see colors when I see music, and yeah. I see those colors I associate directly with emotion. And I think that music is so short now. I think our attention span as millennials is like, you drop a song, it's dope, and then it goes away. And that's just how people digest music. And it's like, I feel like I want to put as much detail into every element of the project that it's like, all right, I listened to the song, it was cool. I listened to the video, I watched the video, it was awesome. I looked at the comic book and that was cool. And now you have 3 separate experiences that you can draw on.
Yeah.
And you know, you can digest those in 3 different ways, and it gives the music a longer life, you know? Because if you drop a good song, it should do well theoretically. It should go where it should go just because it's a good song and you put a good amount of work into it and you did a good job, and if it's a good song, people will resonate with it. But will they resonate with it longer if you don't have that entire package, that entire thing? And I just don't think a lot of artists are doing that. And I wanted to kind of bring that 360 element back into music, because I think a lot of us independent artists don't think of ourselves as brandable material. Like, I think of myself as a brand, and I think of Tommy as a brand, and I think of No Platform as a brand, and Sanny and Kazia were a brand, and I think our merchandise has to be unique. Would you sell the same thing as Bed Bath and Body Works if you were Bed Bath and Beyond? Like, are you going to sell the same exact candles as someone else? Are you going to do the same if you're like a Walmart or Target? There's definitely a difference in certain quality of things in the certain things, because they're different brands.
Yeah.
And I think we have to be, as a different brand, bring different stuff to the table. And I think the comic book was our first step into that idea for it. And we'll see how that goes. I mean, if it doesn't do that well or it doesn't do that great, we'll go back to the drawing board and try something else. But we just want to keep trying to show that our brand is different than the next brand. Our brand is something that is marketable. Our brand is something that's sellable. Our brand is something bigger than just us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of what I wanted to do with that one.
Mm-hmm. So just wrapping things up now, while we're at it, anyone you want to give a shout out to that's not here right now? Could be,
man, gotta shout out my mom. Gotta shout out my mom and my dad. But no, I really want to shout out Calais, because Calais has shown us so much support.
Calais keep it lit
has shown us more support than a lot of other people, and he's sent me songs, and he's allowed me to get on songs that, you know, I had no business being on, honestly, because they're, you know, with artists that are more popular, and it's just, I, you know, respect that, what he's done for us. Definitely a shout out to Pilo, because, you know, Pilo helped jumpstart our career and get us respected in the Bay. And I think definitely a special thanks to Tommy's parents, who let us blap all night every night. Because without them, I don't know where we'd record.
Yeah.
Do you have anyone that you want to say a special shout out to?
You shouted them out, definitely. Yeah. Man, shout out to my grandma, man. You know, she'd be praying for our music, you feel me?
She definitely does.
That's what's up.
Yeah, she definitely does.
Definitely. She definitely adds an amount of sauce onto it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Shout out to mom and dad, you know. And
definitely.
Hey, man. Big shout out to ourselves and to you, bro.
Oh, thank you so much again for letting us come up here and talk.
Yeah, man.
Nah, thank y'all, man. Like, I said, it's just, I thought it was tough I just personally thought it was tough to, you know, just reach out to any artists or musicians, but it really just takes like a, oh, really appreciate, you know, what you're doing. It's just a thank you, and then, oh, like, hey, this is the platform I'm using. How can I help you,
definitely,
know, become
definitely
a better person? Like,
and
I
we,
said.
We appreciate you for thanking of us for that. It's awesome.
Most def.
Awesome, like the connections of being from the Bay all the way out
That's
here.
That's crazy out here too, man.
Yeah, you gotta rep that fam stuff for sure.
Exactly.
Yeah, definitely, bro.
But man.
That's what it's all about.
Yeah.
But last thing. Where can people find you on social media? It's really important.
Definitely.
So y'all can turn those notifications on, you feel me? Definitely
turn those notifications on because the project dropping anytime soon.
ASAP.
My Twitter and my Instagram are Mayflower Jammy.
Spell that out.
M-A-Y-H-E-W. What am I talking about? I don't even know how to spell Mayflower.
Hold on.
All
right, wait. Rewind, y'all.
Rewind. I'll see about my last name. That's a little funny. M-A-Y-F-L-O-W-E-R-J-A-M-M-Y.
Mayflower Jammy.
Yes.
Yeah, my social media is also can be found as, it's 6 and then I-C-K and then A-S-S.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
we're fine with that.
You feel me?
As long as we don't say it, we're chilling.
Yeah, we're chilling.
It's all good.
I'll read the disclaimer. Mm. UC Regions, if I have to, but okay. I'll put the links of their social media below on this link, all that stuff. But make sure to listen to Jammy's and Thomas Jordan's new sounds coming ASAP, y'all. Fire is coming ASAP soon. It's real coming soon. Coming real soon. You'll hear a lot of it play here on 88.1 FM KZSC Santa Cruz. Sanny and Chris back now. But once again, thank y'all so much
for this opportunity.
It, you know, like I said, really means a lot with all these connections we're making, especially what you guys are doing, the platform you're using, the connections you all are making, and just what you're doing for the community. It really needs to be out there. You know, we're too busy talking about negativity, etc. How about let's focus on the people who are really doing something with their life, you know, actually trying to help other people and just open their arms for everyone to be successful. And that's needs to be known. And shout out to y'all for everything.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks, for real.
I appreciate it.
Yeah, you the one, bro.
Yep.
Shout out DJ Riz.
Hey, shout out. Thanks to y'all. Mm-hmm. All y'all, we're about to close it out to some Edibles, the remastered version. That's cool.
Yeah, for sure we do that.
All right, y'all. Peace out. One love. Peace, love. Aloha. DJ Riz. Out with Jammy.
Yee.
Thomas Jordan. Sanny.
No platform. Love team
and
on
Chris.
Everything.
Love everybody. Enjoy.
Let the edibles kick in. She don't wanna listen. She all up in my bed now. She just wanna kick it. But I just wanna love somebody through the night. We ain't gotta go nowhere. Let's get high. But I just wanna love somebody.